Well, hi there. Scorpions are such incredible creatures. They're arthropods, meaning they have an exoskeleton, which they molt as they grow, and they have jointed appendages, sort of like a suit of armor. When your skeleton is on the outside, if you didn't have joints, you wouldn't be able to move. And so, as arthropods, they have jointed appendages. And scorpions have some of the raddest appendages of any arthropod. Like all arachnids, they have 8 walking legs and 2 pedipalps, but these pedipalps are modified into rad grasping claws. But the claws don't even end there, because directly in front of their mouths are the chelicerae. Unlike spider chelicerae, which are modified into fangs, these remain as rad and terrifying claws that shred food, sometimes alive. However, the lack of fangs does not mean that scorpions are not venomous. For around back is the telson, a venom-injecting apparatus located at the end of a tail-like metasoma. In addition to this impressive arsenal of weapons, on their underside they have a pair of pectens, which detect chemical and physical stimuli. Oh, and they glow under ultraviolet light, which should not be present in the enclosure generally. Scorpions can make a very reasonable case for being, pound for pound, the most hardcore little alien monsters on the planet. But they also make great pets, and the emperor scorpion is probably the most widely kept of them all. But is the emperor scorpion a good pet? And is it the best pet invertebrate for you? To help you figure this out, we are going to score the emperor scorpion based on our 5 categories, which are handleability, care, hardiness, availability, and upfront costs. When it comes to handleability, we give the emperor scorpion a score of 3 out of 5. The reality is that emperor scorpions are probably the most handleable of all scorpions. For a scorpion, they have a very relaxed personality and are unlikely to become defensive. Though they can sting, the sting is uncommon and is generally not particularly serious, though you could potentially have an allergic reaction like some people do to bee stings. They are also not nearly as fragile as our tarantulas. That said, there is no reason outside of personal enjoyment that you should need to handle scorpions regularly. They don't require social interaction, and accidents can happen. Additionally, even though they're unlikely to sting, they've also got those claws, and those hurt some if they use them to pinch you. And frequent handling can lead to injury and stress for the scorpion. I'd say keep handling to a minimum if you choose to handle them at all. However, for a scorpion, these are pretty easy to handle. I want to take just a moment to say thank you to our rad fans and stinking rad fans at Patreon who make so many amazing things possible for us. In fact, they are a big part of the reason that we were able to get this emperor scorpion for the reptile room. We want to do more presentations involving all sorts of rad arthropods, and so we've been getting a few thanks to the support from our patrons at Patreon. And I want to add a couple of the big perks of being a patron. One of them is, you'll notice at the end of this video, we show the names of our stinking rad fans. That is just one of the ways that we say thank you for all that you guys do for us. But there's more, because after those names come up, if you've ever stuck around, and you should totally stick around, you will notice that there are some bloopers and added things at the end of every one of our videos. But there's a lot more than just that happens when we film. There's all sorts of cool content. Jason and Michelle always have some rad questions for me about the animals. And all of that additional content gets made into an extra video every single week for our patrons at Patreon called Patreon Extras. So if you haven't already checked out our Patreon, please give it a thought, because it does so much for us, and hopefully we're able to pay it forward to you in some degree. When it comes to care, we give the emperor scorpion a score of 5 out of 5. Care for an emperor scorpion is fairly simple. You're gonna wanna have an enclosure that favors ground space. I wanna be clear about something. This enclosure here is not really set up for this scorpion long-term. This is just so I can show it to you guys and so it won't run off the table and injure itself. When you are building an enclosure for your emperor scorpion though, you are gonna wanna favor floor space, like this enclosure does, over vertical space. These guys are gonna spend most of their time at the ground level. You're gonna wanna have a lid. which is one thing that this enclosure does not have. These aren't climbers. They're not going to climb up the glass, but it's amazing sometimes what arthropods can climb. If they find a bead of silicone or something up the side, it's possible they could get out, and then you've got to explain that to your family. One of the reasons I stress that this isn't a proper enclosure for a scorpion is because this enclosure does not have nearly enough substrate in it. You're going to need a substrate that can hold some moisture. Drying out is a risk for scorpions, and that means it needs to be, well, much deeper than the substrate in here. This substrate would dry out really in just a few hours. You need it deep enough so that there's a lot of volume compared to that big surface area. I would recommend a mixture involving eco-earth, sand, and moss. You can also include other things like vermiculite in that mixture. In addition to that damp substrate, make sure that your scorpion has access to water. And you should need a heat source only if your home is very cool. And I want to be really clear about exactly what you'll need to do with that heat source. I'm telling you this with a big asterisk next to it. If you need additional heat, a heat pad on a thermostat is probably the way to go. The reason I don't even want to tell you that is because most people are going to install this heat pad in a way that can be very, very dangerous for a scorpion. Scorpions are going to burrow down into their substrate when they get too warm. So they're going to seek cooler environments, cooler microhabitats, deeper under the substrate. This is fairly typical, actually, for lots of types of animals, especially animals that live in places that get very hot. Usually, it's cooler deep underground. If your heat pad is on the bottom of the tank, the deeper they get, the hotter it's going to become. And they might not be able to figure this out, and you could easily lose your scorpion as a consequence. So you're going to want to put that heat pad on the side and make sure it's on a thermostat so it doesn't get too hot in there. Scorpions are going to eat insects, but really just a couple each week. And, you know, this is largely because arthropods are awesome and most of them don't need to eat very much. And the way that they eat is absolutely terrifying and awesome. Like I mentioned before, these guys have pedipalps, which are feeding assistance appendages up front. Spiders have pedipalps as well. But the difference here is these pedipalps have big claws on them. And so generally the way these are going to eat is they're going to grab food with these claws. Usually they don't even involve the stinger. They just start lowering a food source right into their mouths, but actually not directly into their mouths, into the chelicerae. And I first became aware of this nightmare a few years ago when I got my first emperor scorpion. And I got this scorpion because I had a lab in which we kept burying beetles. This was for my master's research. And burying beetles are awesome, but as part of the research, I was producing hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of these beetles, and we had to cull some of them off. We had to get rid of some because we just had more than we could possibly keep. And I hated just throwing them into the freezer. I felt much better about feeding them to something. And so I had black widows, and I had praying mantises, and I had an emperor scorpion in my lab for taking care of some of these excess beetles. And what I discovered with that emperor scorpion is it would grab the beetles, and it would just start lowering them, often head first, into the overly eager chelicerae, which, like some sort of a freaky insect disassembling conveyor belt machine, start working and going well before the beetle would even get to them. It's just like they're waiting. It's just like, oh, I can't wait until you get here. I got plans for you. And they would just lower those beetles head first into the horror of chelicerae claws. And it was awesome and freakishly terrifying. They're so spectacular and so horrifying. When it comes to hardiness, we give the emperor scorpion a score of 4 out of 5. Most of the large ones that you're going to see for sale are imports, which means they may have import issues. Captive bred babies can also be a bit fragile. This is sort of the case for young arthropods generally. And humidity, especially around molts, is going to be the most important, especially with those juveniles, because juveniles are molting often and their new soft little cuticles are very, very thin and easily damaged. A lot can go wrong around these molts if they're not properly hydrated. So paying attention to humidity will be the most important, especially when they're young. Also, make sure you get your temps right, especially that they're not getting too hot. Other than that, they should do really well. And they can live for well over a decade. And that is a long time for an arthropod, so that's stinking rad. When it comes to availability, we give the emperor scorpion a score of 4 out of 5. In the past, this would have been a 5 out of 5 for sure. But in recent years, availability has been off and on. Imports stopped for a time, and hopefully this encouraged more good breeders to start working with these because they're amazing, arguably the best pet scorpions that there are. And for a long time, breeders were sort of overlooking them because you could buy them for somewhere between $5 and $20 as imports, and so it's just not worth the hassle. But knowing that they may or may not be available in the future, hopefully that sent a message to people that we gotta start establishing these as a good captive bred population because we don't wanna lose these from the hobby. They're incredible. That said, right now, at least at the moment that this video is being filmed, they are being imported. You can get them online, at expos, and at many pet stores. When they aren't being imported, probably the best place to find them will be directly from breeders online. And I do want to show you something really quickly. Here with me right now, I have a second scorpion. This scorpion is also a giant black scorpion with great big claws. It looks a heck of a lot like an emperor scorpion. This scorpion is an Asian forest scorpion, and I would say most people can't distinguish between these two. Sometimes you may even see Asian forest scorpions for sale as emperor scorpions, but they aren't. And I want to talk to you for just a moment about how to distinguish between the two, and also tell you why you'd want to be able to distinguish between the two. The biggest thing that I've noticed that makes it really easy to tell the difference is looking very closely at the claws. If you look at the claws on an emperor scorpion, you will notice that they're covered in a lot of small tactile hairs that can sense vibrations. But there's quite a bit of hair on these claws, and they've kind of got some dimpling to them where those hairs come out, almost like they've got goosebumps on their claws, and then those hairs. The Asian forest scorpion has far, far fewer hairs. The claws are very, very smooth and almost entirely hairless. And so if you're trying to decide if the scorpion you're looking at is an emperor scorpion or an Asian forest scorpion, the claws are probably the easiest way to distinguish between the two. And the reason you'd want to know the difference is largely because the Asian forest scorpion is a much more aggressive and defensive scorpion, which has its pros and cons. That can be really fun. They're very active. They're going to be very, very aggressive towards food, but they're also going to be more defensive towards you. I already said I don't necessarily encourage handling of even emperor scorpions. But if you want to handle a scorpion, be very, very careful about which scorpion you choose. Because the emperor, you probably won't have any problems. The Asian forest scorpion, you'll probably have some problems. But they're both stinking rad. And this Asian forest scorpion comes to us courtesy of Animal Ark in Orem, Utah. So if you are looking for an Asian forest scorpion or an emperor scorpion or really any sort of rad arthropod, Animal Ark's a great place to go. On top of that, they currently are specializing in all sorts of rad plants, like this one over here, which is a variegated Monstera delicosa. I've never seen one before in person. It's so cool. And it would be amazing if you were building a really big tank. They've got so many cool plants right now, so definitely check them out. When it comes to upfront costs, we give the emperor scorpion a score of 5 out of 5. These scorpions at times have been crazy cheap, but even when you buy them captive bred now, they still seem to be pretty affordable. Prices may go up in the future if importation stops, but honestly, you know, even if this was like a $200 scorpion, which it is not, it would be worth it. This is one of the biggest and coolest and nicest scorpions that exists. If you want a pet scorpion, this is the one to have. And so it really would be worth it. But as it stands right now, you can have them for considerably less than that. The enclosure that you need for them is also very reasonable. It's gonna be one of the cheaper aquaria that you can find with a lid that doesn't even have to be a spectacular lid. If you need a heat pad and thermostat, that will increase the cost. But again, if you don't need one, I would recommend not having one. The substrate, even though you're gonna need quite a bit of it, it's inexpensive. You're gonna need a water bowl, some simple hides, but even the food, even if we included the food, which we do not, but even if you included the food down the road, that's also going to be inexpensive. They're a very reasonable creature to keep when it comes to costs. And these reasons are why we give the Emperor Scorpion an overall score of 4.2 out of 5. Scorpions are totally rad. And this one is not only one of the biggest and coolest looking, but it might be the best pet scorpion as well. If what you want is that, then the Emperor Scorpion might be the best pet invertebrate for you. As always, like and subscribe, and we hope to see you real soon. Well, hi there.
No, count more.
No, well, hi there.
You're just getting your chin.
These are blind you sort of lights.
That's fine.
Oh, jeez. It's not a good idea.